Good afternoon. I am Brooke Clement, and as Acting Director of the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library and Museum, it is my pleasure to welcome you to this afternoon's virtual family book talk, Exploring the White House Inside America's Most Famous Home with author Kate Andersen Brower. While today's program is geared towards families, we do have more of our traditional author talks lined up for next month. We are collaborating with the White House Historical Association for an event on February 4th entitled Slavery in the President's Neighborhood, The Complicated Past, and the Paradoxical Relationship Between Slavery and Freedom in the Nation's Capital. And on February 11th, we are welcoming Dr. David Hamilton Golland to discuss his book, A Terrible Thing to Waste, Arthur Fletcher and the Conundrum of the Black Republican. We hope you'll join us. Kate Andersen Brower is no stranger to the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Library and Museum stage. It is an honor to welcome her back. I will now turn it over to Claire Schubert, Director of Engagement and Programming with the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation, to begin our program.
Thank you, Brooke. And as always, a big thank you to the Gerald R. Ford Presidential Foundation, Museum, and Library for continued support of our educational programs. My name is Claire Schubert. I'm coming to you from the Gerald Ford Foundation in Grand Rapids, Michigan, but I don't think I'm fooling anyone with my virtual background. Like most of you watching us today, I am at home as well, but I thought I'd throw up this picture of our beautiful museum in Grand Rapids. Typically, my job is to teach a lot of kids, like a lot of you guys watching, in some pretty amazing field trips in that museum. But since the world has turned virtual, we're really excited to present some virtual programming like the one that you are joining us for today. So just a quick reminder to our audience, the Q&A box will be open. If you have a question for our speaker at any time during the program, just throw your question in that box. About the last 10 minutes of our program will focus on questions from the audience. So drop your question in the Q&A box. Let us know where you're from. We'd love to hear what's on your mind. But first, I want to tell you a little bit about our author and our speaker today, Miss Kate Andersen Brower. Kate is an author, a number one best-selling author of books for adults, including The Residence and First Women. But today, we're going to be learning about her first book for young readers called Exploring the White House Inside America's Most Famous Home. Kate also is a journalist who works for CNN. She reported on the Obama administration for Bloomberg News. She's worked for CBS, for Fox News. She has written for Vanity Fair, The New York Times, and The Washington Post. Kate lives outside of Washington, D.C. with her husband and her three children and their dog. Now, her kids are about the same age as some of you watching, and I've heard that they were put to work as book reviewers for mom's latest book, so I bet that was fun to get feedback from the kids. So, Kate, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Claire. I'm excited to be here.
And before we really dig into the book, I want to acknowledge that, you know, our nation is getting ready to celebrate something really, really special, a presidential inauguration, meaning a new president and new first family will be moving into the White House. But we know that our viewers are watching the news and they're seeing what's going on, and there's history being made moment to moment in our world right now. But I think it's really important to do programming like this for kids and for adults so that we can really teach people what things like presidential inaugurations typically are like and historically are like. So Kate, if you wouldn't mind maybe taking the first few moments here to give us an overview of the book, but also letting us know why you felt it was really important to write a book like this for young readers.
Well, first of all, thanks everyone for being a part of this today. My kids are 8, 7, and 2, and we have a Wheaton Terrier, and my son's favorite chapter was about White House ghosts. He's very excited about ghosts. And now he's reading everything he can about ghosts. And so I hope I haven't kept him up too late at night, getting, you know, a little bit nervous about whether I've given him nightmares. So I thought this would be a fun book to do for kids because I have kids in this age group, you know, like you, who are interested in history and politics, and then the inauguration that's coming up next week. I mean, this is amazing history that's going to be happening before our eyes. And I think it's really important to know what's happened in the past and to look at how inaugurations have gone before compared to now. I mean, for instance, we know that there will the resident staff at the White House is going to be moving the Bidens in and the Trumps out, just like they did 4 years ago. And that there's this tradition in this country, we're the oldest democracy. And I think there's a lot of pride in that peaceful transfer of power that happens. Definitely this inauguration day is different. It's the first time a president has not gone to his successor's inauguration since 1869, when Andrew Johnson did not go to Ulysses S. Grant's inauguration. So that's a long, long time ago. And we know that there's been, you know, a lot of crazy things happening in the news lately. And I think it's important to just have a baseline understanding of the way things normally go. And our country's been through hard times before. So I really wanted to make this a book that could help unite people. And hopefully it's certainly not partisan in any way. It's meant to pay tribute to the incredible first ladies and the resident staff who've worked at the White House. So let me, should I go ahead and share my screen now, Claire, or am I?
Yeah, let's see some of these great pictures. I know Kate's prepared some pictures that also appear in the book and some of them don't, but they give a great overview to kind of what you can expect if you haven't already got your copy.
Yes.
During the White House.
Okay, so here, here's the cover. It's it was really fun because I've never designed a cover or worked with a publisher on a cover for a children's book, and I think they did a great, great job. I mean, they wanted to make it look like the White House. So you have two the top floors there. They have this that meant to look like the East Room where there's a first lady. Upstairs there is a housekeeper and a valet, and then in the bottom at the bottom there, there's a flower shop and the kitchen. And that's actually true. There is a basement level, two basement levels at the White House. So it's a lot bigger than it looks. Here is moving day at the White House. It is the resident staff's job to move family in, and they do not rely on movers for security reasons, which is pretty incredible. And it is about 95, there are about 95 resident staffers. They're there from one administration to the next, regardless of political party. These are florists, cooks, housekeepers. And I believe the gentlemen in green here are in the operations department. So they're moving, their main job is moving day. And so next week, when all this stuff is going on at the Capitol, where the Joe Biden's being sworn in, think about what's going on at the White House. It's really a lot. A lot is happening. Mattresses are being brought in. We can talk about that later, but it's a lot of things you don't think about. This is Abigail Adams in the East Room. I put this in because the Adams were the first to live in the White House, the first president and first lady. So that's a little bit of trivia. And it was a mess when Abigail moved in. She said, you know, that she had to walk up these wooden planks to get into the house. The East Room is a beautiful, elegant room now. And here it is being used to hang up laundry. So a lot has changed. Here in the book, I have this diagram also of different areas in the White House that you wouldn't know were there. The ground floor is, you know, where the when you see the president coming in or talking to reporters on the South Lawn before he walks to the helicopter, for instance, he's coming in and out of the diplomatic reception room, which is on the bottom floor. Next to that is the map room. I won't go through every single thing, but there's a cool trivia fact about the map room, which is that during World War II, the D-Day invasion plans were pinned up on the walls of the map room. And it was so top secret that FDR had, when they had to be vacuumed, that he made sure there was security in the room and that the plans were all covered so that nobody, not even anyone on the resident staff, could see what those plans were, because it could risk lives. So there's just incredible history going on in the White House all the time. It is 55,000 square feet from the East Wing to the West Wing. It is a football field long. It cost $230,000 to build. In today's money, that's nearly $4.4 million. George Washington selected the site of the Capitol City and future White House, but he's the only president never to have lived there. I live outside of Washington, D.C., and he didn't live far from me in Mount Vernon, and it's a great place to visit if you're ever down here. It's incredible, his house. Beautiful view of the Potomac River. It's really pretty. The president is never allowed to drive. Instead, he travels in a motorcade more than a dozen cars long. I think Claire and I are going to talk a little bit about his car, which is very interesting, to say the least. And then the White House has 132 rooms, 147 windows, 35 bathrooms, 28 fireplaces, 8 staircases, and 3 elevators. If White House housekeepers see that the second floor is busy or the president and first lady need privacy for whatever reason, they can go up a side staircase to the third floor, make their way all across the third floor, and come back the other side so they don't have to disturb them. We're going to talk about White House pets later. This is one of the weirdest pets. I think it's a raccoon named Rebecca. This is Grace Coolidge, who was sent this raccoon for Thanksgiving dinner, which is kind of gross. And she decided that instead of eating Rebecca, she would keep Rebecca. And she put her on a leash and would walk her around the South Lawn. Here are the Kennedys. You know, the Kennedy family is one of the most fascinating families to live in the White House. There's Caroline and John F. Kennedy Jr. playing in the Oval Office. And there's President Kennedy just having fun with his kids. John F. Kennedy Jr. was a newborn when he moved into the White House with his mother. And his mother was the first lady to have a newborn baby since the turn of the century. So that's really amazing to have a tiny baby in the White House. And I've read that he doesn't really have many memories of it, which is, too bad that he didn't have many memories because he was so very little at the time. So this is Caroline Kennedy in the kindergarten in the solarium. Her parents made this kindergarten for her and invited her friends to come. And it's just amazing to me that there is an actual classroom, like classrooms you all go to, before the coronavirus, a normal classroom. And here she is with her friends having a kind of normal time. You know, you would think it's decorated completely, like linoleum floors and all that. And it's just amazing that it's in the White House and it's on the third floor with amazing views of the Capitol, the Washington Monument. This is Richard Nixon and one of the kitchen staff, Frank Blair, bowling. Late one night, they bowled more than once together. It was really just shows that relationship between the resident staff and the president and the first family. He just wandered into the kitchen and said, "You want to go bowling with me?" And Frank said, "Sure." And I think people don't think about that dynamic. And here is the Fords on the left and the Nixons on the right. And, you know, I think we know, and Claire and I have talked about this, the famous photo is of Richard Nixon doing this kind of, I don't know if it's the peace sign or whatever that famous image is of him in front of the helicopter, but this is them walking to the helicopter. He is the only president to have resigned. He was not impeached. He knew that he probably would have been impeached, and so he resigned before that could happen. Here's Susan Ford at her prom, which is pretty cool, in the East Room of the White House. Her parents made her pay for the prom, so she and her friends hosted bake sales, and they made their own table decoration centerpieces. It's just a really fun, I think, amazing thing, the only prom to be held in the White House. This is President Ford with the golden retriever Liberty. And Claire was telling me that Liberty can make little, that was basically Liberty's autograph, I think, a signed photo was.
Called a potograph.
Oh, a potograph, yes. I love that. How many of those did you guys, do you think they sent out?
Oh my goodness, so many. You can actually go to the library website and read letters written to Liberty. And Liberty started to get so much mail that the Ford's daughter, Susan, was put in charge of responding to it. So it was her job to write back. And they actually did use Liberty's paw at first, but they got so much mail for Liberty that they made a rubber stamp of her paw print, and that became the pantograph. So yeah, really, really fun. I don't think Susan ever would have predicted that would have been a job or a response.
No. I think it's a pretty creative way of not having the president have to sign a bunch of stuff or the first lady, and they often use auto pen anyway, right? So this is like much cooler than getting an auto pen signed.
Totally. And maybe the only dog that ever had an auto pen, right?
I'm not. Yeah, I think so. I love that story. Here, and we're getting two new dogs in the White House. The Bidens are bringing two new dogs, so that'll be fun. Here's Betty Ford standing on the cabinet room table. Always said she wanted a seat at the table, so she asked White House photographer David Kennerly, who was very close to the Ford family, to take this photo of her. She was a trained dancer, and I just think it's a lighthearted, fun picture. She was probably, I know she was sad about his loss, but I do wonder if she was kind of relieved to leave. A lot of first ladies, I think, breathe a sigh of relief. Michelle Obama wrote about that a little in her book too. This is Christine Limerick. She was the head housekeeper at the White House. She's a wonderful woman. She's somebody who ran the housekeeping department, and so was in charge of about 20 housekeepers. And she is very much involved in, you know, when there is a transition, what's happening next week, she often will oversee it. She helped oversee the Trump transition, and I've heard that she's overseeing the Biden transition too. So she's looking at what the housekeepers are doing, overseeing the deep clean, which is really making sure, you know, mattresses are moved, headboards are changed, everything's clean. Chandeliers are dusted. Nothing is overlooked. This is James Ramsey, one of my favorite butlers at the White House. He's standing in the West Sitting Hall, and that is the half moon window that's so beautiful in the West Sitting Hall. There he is with George W. Bush. When James unfortunately passed away a couple of years ago, Laura Bush actually traveled to Washington, D.C. to give the eulogy at his funeral, and her daughter Jenna was with her. And there were statements read from the Obamas and the Clintons about how much he lightened their day and brightened their day and made the White House feel more like a home, because that's what the resident staff wants to do. They want to make the president and his family feel comfortable. There's a chapter in the book on first ladies, because I think they're endlessly fascinating, and I think that their contributions get overlooked sometimes. What Laura Bush did after 9/11 is in the book, really helping hold the country together. You know, Hillary Clinton's attempt to take on, you know, she took on healthcare reform and how that worked for her, and, you know, the role of the first lady and how each woman has to define it herself. And it's not an easy job. So here are the Bush daughters and the Obama daughters, and the Bush daughters came to the White House especially to meet Sasha and Malia Obama and show them how you slide down this banister outside the solarium in the White House. And the solarium is on the third floor. It's like a family room. Laura Bush invited Michelle Obama twice to the White House. So between the election in November and the inauguration in January, so the point that we're at right now, normally the first lady invites the new first lady to come to the White House. And that is that.
Okay. All right. Well, I've got tons of questions. I'm sure our audience does too. Let's start with inauguration. So presidential inauguration is right around the corner, which means moving day at the White House. Now, I have a memory when I was a little girl, we moved into a new house. And I remember on moving day, we got to our new house and the old owners were still there eating dinner. And even as a little girl, I knew that was awkward. So I'm wondering, what is it like at the White House when a president is moving out and a new president is moving in? Tell us a little bit about what that interaction typically is like between those, the outgoing and incoming president, and what is Inauguration Day, Moving Day? Tell us a little bit about what that's like.
I think it's very hard for this, for the president and the first lady, right? They don't want to say goodbye to the people that they knew for so long. I think there's part of them that wants to leave, but that, you know, they say goodbye in the morning. So the new president and first lady go to usually to St. John's Church, and then they go to the White House for a coffee in the Blue Room with the outgoing president and first lady and the vice president and his or her wife, or her husband in this case with Kamala Harris, are there. And they take a motorcade to the Capitol. But before that, there's a really sweet thing that happens in the state dining room where the resident staff gather to say goodbye to the president and the first lady and their kids. And I've been told by resident staff that there's usually not a dry eye in the room. You know, they feel very emotional. Barbara Bush told me it was just the hardest part of that day was saying goodbye to the butlers who she had grown so close to. So that's a big part of that day. And you're right, it is kind of like moving into a new house. Then the new family comes in after the parade. And the great part about it is they don't have to do the move. So they are not unpacking things. They get in, their favorite shampoo is in the bathroom. Their favorite food is stocked in the family kitchen upstairs. Their clothes are all hung up, except there's a great story about Hillary Clinton losing her inauguration ball gown. And somehow it had been misplaced and the resident staff went on this huge frantic search for it and they eventually found it. But sometimes things do get misplaced along the way. But so it is just kind of like any move. You're moving into a new home. The president and first lady who are leaving are really sad. And sometimes they'll take the helicopter from the Capitol and do one final swing above the White House to say goodbye, which I think is sweet.
Yeah, and it's nice to hear that. You know, I'm sure the outgoing president isn't always happy about leaving, or maybe isn't even happy about who's moving in, but that we have this rich tradition of that peaceful transfer of power, even within the home that day, and even within the residence, making that as peaceful as possible. You mentioned earlier, you know, I'm really interested in the president's car. So you said that the president is not allowed to drive. I can't imagine not being able to drive a car for like 4 to 8 years, really. I loved reading in your book about the beast, the president's car. In fact, I put it down and I said, did you guys know that the president's car has a supply of blood in it at all times? I did not know that. So I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit more about the president's car and also just how the Secret Service works to keep the president and first family safe.
It's interesting that you bring up a supply of blood because I sometimes don't mention it to kids because I don't want to scare anybody, but it's just for emergencies because, you know, everybody has different blood types. And so if there is something that happens and he needs a transfusion or whatever, they know what kind of blood type he has and then they can do this procedure. So everything is worst case scenario. They have to plan for that. You know, it's huge. It's 7 tons, the beast. It's got a ventilation system. It can withstand a chemical attack. It's got the ability to spray off tear gas. Its wheels can't be ruptured. I don't know how that's possible. You know, obviously there is bulletproof glass. And so it's definitely the most high-tech car you can find. And the Secret Service works really hard to protect the president and the first lady. They didn't start really officially until President McKinley's assassination that was 1902 when they really officially started. Before then, in like the 1860s, they were more like the IRS. I mean, they were looking for counterfeiters. They were more doing financial work. So now you have thousands of specialty trained officers. And if you see them, they're often wearing black suits and they're wearing sunglasses. Sasha and Malia Obama would call them the secret people. And they get to be friends with them. Steve Ford told Chelsea Clinton, you know, before she moved into the White House, he wrote her a letter and said, make friends with your Secret Service agents because they will be the ones you see all the time, whether you like it or not. So I think it's such an interesting position to be in. And they, I have not interviewed any Secret Service agents, honestly, but next to the resident staff, they're probably the hardest people to interview because they are so, I mean, they're so bound to secrecy and they're really all about safety and protecting the president. Although I will say next to, there's a role that, that the resident staff plays too, because the cook, one of the executive chefs who I interviewed said, look, we're also protecting the president, making sure that all of his food is safe to eat. You know, they would taste his food sometimes before he ate it. I mean, it's something that they actually, one really interesting fact, and then I'll stop talking about this, but I could talk about this topic forever because I just think it's so interesting. There is a storeroom manager at the White House, and he drives in an unmarked van to a supermarket in Washington, D.C., and I never could find out which one, and just goes grocery shopping for the family because nobody would ever suspect that this random person was buying bananas and, you know, whatever, lemonade for the president and the first lady. And so who would ever try to poison or do anything with that food? So there's a whole elaborate system around keeping the president and his family safe.
Absolutely. Well, you mentioned Steve Ford, and Steve is the son of President Ford and Mrs. Betty Ford. He was a teenager when his dad somewhat unexpectedly became the president and moved into the White House. So here you had this very kind of normal middle-class family and all of a sudden dad's president and we're living in the White House. I tell kids it's like the plot of a Disney movie. So Steve, being a teenager and suddenly in the White House, thinks this is amazing, calls up a friend and says, you got to check this place out. They head up to the roof of the White House with a boombox, which is like a great big stereo that plays music. Some kids might not know that term. They take their boombox up to the roof and they start blasting rock and roll songs, a song called Stairway to Heaven. And Steve has this very vivid memory of being on the roof of the White House blasting this music. Now, I don't think that that could ever actually happen today because of security measures, but there's been a lot of kids of all different ages living in the White House. And I wonder if you have any funny stories of kids misbehaving while living in the White House.
There are stories of kids misbehaving. Actually, there's a fun story of Barbara Bush's grandkids going to the basement. It was actually, I believe it was Jenna and Barbara Bush, but I have this story in the book and I don't want to say anything about anyone in particular. Isn't true, there are other grandchildren too, but they were down in the bowling alley and they thought it was so cool. They were visiting their grandparents and they were going to call the kitchen and ask for hamburgers and milkshakes and because you get anything you want and have it delivered downstairs to them in the bowling alley while they bowled. And when Barbara Bush found that out, she was livid. She said, you know, these people are not working for you and you don't get to boss anybody around. So come right upstairs with that food. I mean, she was really upset by that. So I think it's hard for parents and grandparents in the White House to really draw the line. There was another fun story about Lucy Johnson in the White House. She had a friend come sleep over and she thought it was so cool. She told me to have a fireplace in her bedroom. She's, oh my gosh. I mean, who is lucky enough to have a fireplace in their bedroom? And she lit a fire and smoke started billowing out. And there was like the room was covered in soot and it was a mess. And she had to like frantically run out and get the resident staff to help put out the fire. And when her mother, Lady Bird Johnson, saw that, she said, you are going to get on your hands and knees and help clean this up. And I think that that's another example of where you have to put your foot down as a parent. You know, Michelle Obama made her daughters make their bed every day. I think it's tricky. And and then there's a story in the book about the Bush daughters having a party and one of them, their friends climbing up on the roof and trying to climb up the flagpole. And this was late at night. And so the resident staff got involved. One of the ushers was summoned upstairs to come help. The Secret Service got involved actually taking this person down. I mean, they were college kids. So it was a bit of a mess. But they didn't, they told me they didn't tell their parents because they're there to kind of protect them.
Right. Well, and you know, I mean, kids are kids and parenting is parenting no matter where that's happening, right?
Yeah.
So besides kids, there's been a lot of animals living in the White House. We talked a little bit about Liberty and all of the fan mail that Liberty got. She was the golden retriever of the Fords, who actually had a litter of puppies while she lived in the White House. Mm-hmm. So sweet. I'm curious, and I bet a lot of our kids watching too are curious as well. There's been a lot of dogs, a lot of cats. How about some of the more unconventional pets? I know we saw Rebecca Raccoon. Tell us about some of kind of the wilder pets that have lived in the White House.
Well, you can't get wilder, I think, than John Quincy Adams, who was given an alligator by the French General Marquis de Lafayette. And that wasn't the only White House alligator. Herbert Hoover's son kept several alligators as pets, occasionally allowing them to wander around the White House lawn. And then I think Eisenhower's 440-pound baby forest elephant is another really crazy one. They ended up giving the elephant to the National Zoo because I don't think there's any place but an elephant in the White House. And so, you know, and there are fun stories about the rowdy kids of Teddy Roosevelt and Abraham Lincoln. Abraham Lincoln's son Tad brought his pony and pet goat inside to sleep by his side at night when he was 7 years old. And then Theodore Roosevelt had a ton of pets. They had dogs, cats, snakes, birds, a one-legged rooster, and a pony named Algonquin. And that is the famous pony that rode in the White House elevator. One of the kids was trying to make his brother, who was sick in bed, feel better. So he brought the pony up in the elevator. I don't even know how you fit. It's a tiny little elevator. But so you name it, there are some crazy, crazy things going on in the White House. Oh, and there was a bobcat named Smokey and a pygmy hippo named Billy when the Coolidges were there too. So it's a lot of crazy pets.
I bet. And I know you've interviewed a lot of White House staffers. I'm sure those crazy pets make their life a little bit more difficult too, trying to care for those animals as well as the family. So you mentioned that you are really passionate about First Ladies. I know that, like me, you're a big fan of First Lady Betty Ford and all that she did for our country. You've also mentioned we are about to have our first woman vice president. And I'm wondering if you have some thoughts on how the role of women in the White House has changed and how you might predict that the First Lady, that role might continue to progress.
Well, I think we're on the precipice of change. Like, I think we're about to see a real change where, you know, you have the first female, right, in Kamala Harris. And I think you can't be something you can't see. I think people say that a lot. And I think for girls around the country to see that, someone who looks like them will be inspirational, hopefully, to girls in the future. And maybe some of you watching want to run for president someday. I mean, I think that it just opens up those possibilities to see it. I know that Betty Ford was a feminist and supported the Equal Rights Amendment. She also wanted her husband to name a woman to the Supreme Court, but he didn't. But I still think he was an amazing president. So I think that I think that we are on the verge of change, and it will be interesting to see Kamala Harris's husband, a second gentleman, and one day we might see a first gentleman and see what that will look like. Will they do some of these traditionally feminine things, like we expect first ladies to host teas and pick out menus and look at seating charts and dress beautifully and all that. So I think the expectations for second gentleman or first gentleman will be different. And so it's exciting to see change, I think.
It is exciting. It's exciting to be here and watching it happen, right?
Yeah.
And you mentioned a lot of our audience members, and maybe they have aspirations of being the president when they grow up or have different careers. I'm wondering if you can share a little bit about your own career as a journalist and an author, and if kids are watching and thinking, wow, I would love to be like her someday and write books or be a reporter and be able to travel around to Washington, D.C. and report on the president. What's your advice for someone who's young and who would like to be a journalist or a writer someday as well?
I think the best advice is to just take whatever opportunities you can and volunteer yourself. I mean, I was working as a producer, and so I was like on the TV side, and I really wanted to be a print reporter. I really wanted to be the one asking questions and writing up interviews. And so I just volunteered to work on weekends when George W. Bush was in office. And so I was at Bloomberg News, and these newsrooms always need people on the weekends just to be there. And so if you are interested in journalism, you just say, okay, I'll take that overnight shift. I'll do that, you know, pay your dues, because like in anything, you've got to pay your dues and sometimes take the hours that people with kids or older people don't want to take. And then that's like your stepping stone. And then I think just ask a lot of questions of the people around you and read a lot.
Awesome. Be curious and read books. Those are two great pieces of advice. Okay, so your job is pretty cool, but if you could have any job in the White House, which one would you pick?
Well, I would pick Chief Usher, because they run the show and they also get to work really closely with the First Lady. And I think that would be really fun. Yeah. And so they're the ones in charge. I mean, it was a Chief Usher who Michelle Obama sent out to South Dakota to pick up to choose the playset that Sasha and Malia had. And that was all something that he did. The Chief Usher is the one that walks the president every morning to the Oval Office and says, you know, what do you need? How's questions as silly as, you know, how was dinner last night? And if the president says, I didn't really like the salmon or whatever, then the Chief Usher goes back to his office and calls up the head chef and says, he didn't like the salmon, you know? So it's just little things like that. And I remember I interviewed the Chief Usher who was there in the early years of the Obama administration. And President Obama was really interested in getting that basketball court up and ready. And so he would ask every day about the basketball court, because that was his way of exercise and fun and release. It's a really stressful job, obviously, being president. And so it was the Chief Usher's job to get the basketball court, you know, ready to go.
Yeah, definitely. Well, like President Ford had a pool put in for the same reason, for that exercise and stress relief. All right, we have some questions from the audience, Kate. So Michael from Flint is wondering, Kate, what's your favorite room in the White House?
Well, my favorite room is the yellow oval room on the second floor, because it's so beautiful and it overlooks the South Lawn. And I think it's just a gorgeous room. But I think that if I could go to any room and just be teleported anywhere right now, it would be, because I like kind of spy novels and everything, would be the Presidential Emergency Operations Center, which is like the bunker underneath the East Wing of the White House, which is where presidents are taken, after 9/11. That's where Bush and Cheney were when Bush came back. It's FDR had it built, and it is very, you know, secure. It is, and I don't really know exactly where it is, because even online, it's hard to get a sense of exactly where it is in the building. And I think that just makes it intriguing.
Right, definitely. Okay, Stan has a question. Do you know, or can you talk about which incoming and outgoing presidents were the most cordial to each other? Is there presidents that had specifically or especially good relationships with one another?
I think that the closest was, Reagan and Bush, because George H.W. Bush had been Ronald Reagan's vice president for 8 years. You know, they had a rapport, they liked each other. And I think also, you know, Obama and George W. Bush got along well. Even though they didn't agree on politics, they were friendly with each other. But there have been tough transitions, not as tough as this, but they have been tough. And I think it's usually one-term presidents. You know, when Gerald Ford lost to Jimmy Carter, you see that concession speech that Betty Ford reads, and Gerald Ford is standing there with tears in his eyes. And, you know, it's pretty heartbreaking. But in the concession speech, he says, I'm here, my job and everyone who works for me is here to support you. And I think that's really an important thing. So I think it's when you lose that one, you know, if you're in for one term and then, as Jimmy Carter said, millions of people don't like me, I think that's a hard thing, pill to swallow for anybody. But they've all done it. They've all done it and been patriotic about it.
Absolutely. It can be hard. And yes, President Ford, he had come down with laryngitis, which is why Betty was giving this speech. And yeah, I think it was heartbroken over it, but he and President Carter became and remained friends for the rest of his life. Jimmy Carter spoke at his funeral. So yeah, things, transitions and change can be hard, that there's a way to do that peacefully, right? We have a question from Bridget. She has a few questions. Have you met presidents personally? And then the next question is, they want to visit the White House, but it seems like a lot of trouble. Is it worth making all the arrangements to do the standard tour of the White House?
Right. Well, right now you can't because of the pandemic, but I think in a normal world, it is definitely worth it. I live in Washington, so I mean, I love Washington. It's also a great place to visit because you can see the Lincoln Memorial and Capitol Visitor Center, which is really amazing. And so there are other places to see, but I think it is worth it. Yes, it is a lot of trouble though, true. You do have to, you know, reach out to your member of Congress. There are some hoops to jump through, but once you get to do it, you actually are standing in a place where so much history has happened. You know, the British burned down the White House in 1814. And to be in a place where there have been tremendous highs and lows, I think it's just incredible. And so, yeah, and as far as meeting presidents, you know, I interviewed President Trump in the Oval Office for a book I wrote about the former President's Club called Team of Five. It's about kind of how Trump will fit in or not with this group of men when he leaves office. And then I've interviewed Jimmy Carter and Rosalynn Carter. I went down to Plains to interview them. And I've interviewed Obama, but in like group settings with other reporters. So for books, it's been Carter and Trump. It's very difficult to get access to presidents. And it's also hard to get access to first ladies, but I talked to Laura and Barbara Bush, which was great.
Wonderful. Okay, last question from the audience, and I think your son would like this question. Can you share any ghost stories, White House ghost stories, or is there a ghost that is seen more than once in the White House?
Yes. The ghost you hear about the most is Abraham Lincoln. And I talked to a White House maid, Betty Finney, a very sweet lady, as she said, she swears that she saw Abraham Lincoln sitting outside the Lincoln bedroom in the hallway with his top hat on, staring straight ahead. And she said she got goosebumps. So, you know, the Lincoln sightings are the ones you hear the most about, but there's another ghost in the book called The Thing, and you can read more about that. But that's another scary ghost that people see. And if you believe in ghosts, I mean, this house, yes, it was burned in 1814 and rebuilt, but I mean, since 1800, there have been people living there. And you've got to think, if you believe in ghosts, this would be a place that would have them.
Right. Well, what a hook to get this book if you don't have it already. So we're nearing the end of our program, but I want to make sure that everyone watching knows that you can get your copy of the book through Schuler Books or on Amazon. It is a great book. It's kind of chapter book style, and I always say you can read it cover to cover, but you can also, hey, if you're super interested in the ghost, you can pick out that chapter and read it first, right? So you can use it as a research resource as well. Parents and adults watching, look for an email to come your way tomorrow that will have links to purchase the book. We're also going to send you some information about the programs that we offer for all ages through the Gerald Ford Foundation and Museum and Library. So look for that. Kate, you have a pretty awesome job, but I like to say I have a pretty great job too, because what I get to do every day is to teach people about President Ford Ford and Mrs. Ford, their lives, their leadership, and really the values that they upheld throughout their lives, of honesty and integrity and civic participation. So those of you watching today, we would love to have your support so that we can continue those educational initiatives. We offer our programs free of cost to schools. And if you're interested in partnering with us and supporting that programming, please look for that email and consider becoming a friend of Ford after this program. We would love to have your support. So Kate, thank you. This has been so fun. Thank you for joining us today. What is your final thought or your send-off or your challenge to the kids watching us today?
Well, first off, I love Betty Ford, as you know, and what she did is so amazing, both for breast cancer and then what she did after she left the White House, just so open and honest. I just have to say she's one of my favorite first ladies to study. I would love to see you kids, if you'd like to talk to an older relative. A lot of my research is interviewing people and often older people about what they've seen in their lives. So if you have a grandparent, an uncle, an aunt, a friend, a neighbor, ask them about what it was like when they were your age and, you know, what did they remember about inauguration, or just ask them about their life. They'll love to have you interested in them. And I think it's just so important to ask those questions. And if you want to, it would be fun to do like a little story, you know, about their life. But I really encourage people to reach out to just older people because they've seen a lot of history and they have great perspective.
Absolutely. History is all around us all the time. And I tell you what, especially right now, those older family members would love a phone call from you. So what a great idea. Well, Kate, thanks so much for joining us for this program today, for contributing to history education in such a big way, and for honoring our kids as readers, as learners, and history makers themselves. So thank you again for joining us.
Thank you, Claire. Thank you.
And thank you to everyone in our audience. It's been a fun program. We hope you learned a lot and enjoy the rest of your week.
Bye.